Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Ukrainian Night, An Intimate History of Revolution by Marci Shore, narrated by Callie Beaulieu. Do you know the Ukrainian Night? No, you do not know the Ukrainian Night. Here, the sky turns black from smoke. Vladimir Mayakovsky. Dok Ukraina, Debt to Ukraine, 1926. Preface. The Ukrainian Revolution of 2013 to 2014 on the Maidan was the most extraordinary thing I have seen in the quarter century I have been coming to Eastern Europe. The political became the existential. I saw friends and colleagues I had known for years making decisions they would have found unimaginable a few months earlier. People who valued their privacy suddenly laid bare their souls. Though I eventually made several trips to Lviv, Kiev, and Dnipropetrovsk, renamed Dnipro in May 2016, I watched the Maidan mainly from Vienna, where I was living that year. Being close enough to Kiev to see Ukrainian friends who were traveling back and forth and at the same time immersed in the media culture of the West, I felt how little this revolution was understood. Journalists and politicians commented on NATO policy, oil pipelines, and international finance, but not on the transformation of human souls. Early in the 20th century, the Polish philosopher Stanisław Zizowski wrote, "What is not biography is nothing at all." This is my point of departure. This book began as a more modest essay, a portrait of the Ukrainian literary translator Yurko Prohasko. The original title was It Was My Choice, A Phenomenology of the Ukrainian Revolution. This phenomenology was in the spirit of Edmund Husserl's philosophy, a description of revolution as pure subjective experience. This book is not an analysis of contemporary politics in Ukraine. I make no arguments or predictions about political outcomes. This is an exploration of revolution as a lived experience given to individuals. I try in this book to understand what pushed some of my own friends and colleagues, people like myself, like ourselves, to places where they had never expected to find themselves. What pushed them towards a willingness to risk their lives? All of them experienced a moment when it was imperative to make a choice. This was choosing in the strongest existentialist sense described by Jean-Paul Sartre. Life is nothing until it is lived. But it is yours to make sense of, and the value of it is nothing else but the sense that you choose. Time and time again I heard, in different languages, it was my choice. Dostoevsky once wrote, Sartre goes on to say, if God did not exist, everything would be permitted. And that, for existentialism, is the starting point. Everything is indeed permitted if God does not exist and man is in consequence forlorn, for he cannot find anything to depend upon either within or outside himself. Sartre tried to move man in the place vacated by God. Marx tried to move history there. The Soviet Union, the materialization of Marxist metaphysics, was modern man's most audacious attempt to replace God. Its failure, and more broadly the failure of Marxism, the last of the grand narratives, arguably brought about the end of modernity as such. Postmodernity began with the relinquishing of attempts to replace God. Now, not only was God dead, but moreover, there was no one and nothing to take his place. The fate of truth in such a world was not so clear. Nearly a quarter century after the fall of communism, The Ukrainian Revolution illuminated anew the border between modernity and postmodernity. It also raised questions about what would come next. With the revolution of 2014, the postmodern ended in Ukraine, wrote the Russian historian Ilya Gerasimov. We still do not know how to conceptualize this new reality. The Ukrainian Revolution on Kiev's Maidan, though bound up with a particular history, simultaneously laid bare universal questions about the nature of selfhood, the plasticity of temporality, and the fate of truth. When does a protest cross an invisible boundary to become a revolution? What brings parents and children together and what splits generations apart? Under what circumstances does fear disappear? How is revolutionary time different from the time of boit, the untranslatable Russian word for the heaviness of everyday life? How are the experiences of time and space altered? Why does the distinction between night and day fade? How is selfhood both realized and overcome by solidarity? What does it mean for people to film themselves being shot? What conditions allow the boundary between reality and fiction to be effaced? The second part of this book, about the aftermath of the Maidan and the war in the Donbass, explores in particular this last question. When the Iron Curtain fell in 1889, Francis Fukuyama declared the end of history. The 18th century Enlightenment, celebrating its faith in reason and truth, had conceived a teleology of progress that seemingly concluded in liberal democracy. So it is perhaps fitting that the end of history be brought about by a discomposing fusion of romantic will and post-factuality. In this world after the end of history, both American capitalism and post-Soviet oligarchy have produced a specialty PR market for gangsters, and reality television has done away with the distinction between the fictional and the real. This is a world where warlords can promote themselves on Instagram and Twitter, and Ukrainian and American oligarchs with presidential aspirations can share a strategic advisor. Karl Marx was untimely when he wrote, "All that is solid melts into air." In the mid-19th century, the observation was still premature. Perhaps this is no longer the case. In a post-factual world, much that seemed solid has melted into air. Yet people remain. This is a work of nonfiction, a history of a revolution as it was experienced by those who chose to take part in it. The purpose of writing history is like that of writing literature, to allow the listener an encounter with alterity, an imaginative leap into another time and place, a possibility of understanding the other. In this sense, I hope that the chapters of this book about the war in the Donbass can play some small role in providing a human face to yet another tragedy of the kind Neville Chamberlain described as a quarrel in a faraway country between people of whom we know nothing. New Haven, January 2017. Note on transliteration. Ukraine is a bilingual country. Ukrainian, the official state language, tends to be dominant in western Ukraine. Russian tends to be dominant in eastern Ukraine. Polish, especially but not exclusively in western Ukraine, is fairly common as well. A century ago, this was also true of Yiddish and German. These generalizations obscure, though, the everyday reality of casual bilingualism. It is normal for conversations to occur in two languages, or for journalists to conduct an interview in one language while the person being interviewed responds in another. In Ukraine, I spoke Russian and Polish and English, occasionally German. In the case of the novelist Serhiy Zadan, for instance, I spoke to him in Polish about a novel he had written in Ukrainian and I had read in English. He spoke to me in Russian. This situation was very Ukrainian. This multilingualism, enriching for Ukraine itself, inevitably causes difficulties for transliteration from Cyrillic to Latin alphabets. Most Ukrainians use more than one version of their names, a Ukrainian version, perhaps a different Russian version, and a medley of diminutives. For example, Ihor in Ukrainian becomes Igor in Russian. Yevhen becomes Yevgen. Mykhailo becomes Mikhail. Alexei becomes Alexei. Oleksandr becomes Alexander. Further, Yoheni or Yevhen or Yevgen becomes Zhenya in diminutive form. Mikhail or Mykhailo becomes Misha. Katarina becomes Katya. Both Alexander and Alexandra become Sasha, while Oleksandr becomes Olez. The Library of Congress has one English transliteration system for Russian and another for Ukrainian, written in the Cyrillic alphabet like Russian, but using a small number of different letters. Both languages transliterate differently into German and Polish than they do into English. Yuri or Yuri Androhovich in German, Yuri Androhovich in Polish, Yuri or Yuri, or Yuri Andrukovich in English. This is a book about individuals, most of whom, in an age of an internet dominated by the Latin alphabet, have already chosen for themselves a Latinized spelling of their names. And so I defer to the choices made by the book's protagonists, Yurko Prohasko rather than Yurko Prohesko, Victoria Narizhna rather than Victoria. Most often I refer to people as I myself address them, making exceptions for clarity when names overlap. Yoheni Monasterski rather than Zhenya due to multiple Zhenyas. Katya Mischenko and Katernya Ivakolenko due to multiple Katyas. Ihor Petrovsky and Igor Stupak, Oleg Repan, and Oleg Marchuk. In referring to names of places in Ukraine, I transliterate from Ukrainian, Luhansk, rather than Lugansk, following the Library of Congress system, yet modifying to avoid diacritical marks. I make an exception in cases where a Russian transliteration has effectively become anglicized and already familiar to English-language listeners. And so, following the New York Times, Kiev rather than Kiev, Odessa rather than Odessa. None of this is meant as an intervention in language politics. My hope is to avoid gratuitously confusing non-Slavic-speaking listeners and to respect the personal, not necessarily political, perhaps more often aesthetic choices of this book's protagonists. These are, of course, imperfect solutions to problems for which there are no perfect solutions. Part 1. Revolution. The Maidan. The sky turns black from smoke. Close to midnight on Tuesday, 18 February 2014, 21-year-old Misha Martinenko, reeking of smoke, returned to the Kiev apartment he shared with his mother, his grandmother, and his 10-year-old sister. He was wearing a white beaded cross around his neck. In his mother's face, Misha saw that she had aged several years since they had parted that morning. He looked in the mirror. His own face was the color of pallid charcoal. His eyes were bulging. He began to cry. Nearly 10 hours later, Misha awoke, still wearing clothing covered with soot and dirt. The city was the same color. That day, the sky in Kiev turned black from smoke. On the streets surrounding the central square known as the Maidan, thousands of people were digging up bricks and paving stones to build barricades. They set fire to clothing and tires and anything else that could burn. They were defending themselves against the Berkutovtsi, the Ukrainian government's specially trained riot police, stormtroopers with gas masks whose eyes it was impossible to see. Their silver shields covered their faces and torsos, creating a moving bunker not easily penetrated by the Molotov cocktails. Far above the flaming barricades, on the rooftop of the high-rise Hotel Ukraina, snipers fired downwards and bodies fell, corpses amidst black smoke. One of those shot in the neck by a sniper was a paramedic named Olesya Zhukovska, who was wearing a white uniform with a red cross. She was exactly Misha's age. As blood poured from her neck, she typed on her phone the Twitter message, "I am dying." The Land of Gogol. On Wednesday evening, 19 February 2014, the political scientist and prominent Ukrainian intellectual, Mykola Rybchuk, lectured to a crowded room in Vienna. Mykola spoke calmly, reflectively. Although he was not optimistic, he was hopeful. He had no doubts that the fight for freedom in Ukraine would continue. Perhaps this time the fight would not succeed, but Mykola was certain that, if not this time, then someday it would. He answered all questions undefensively. He said nothing to the audience of the fact that his wife and their 26-year-old son were in Kiev, that his son Yuri had returned home at 4 that morning and was now on the Maidan once again, that Mykola did not know whether or not Yuri would be killed there that night, perhaps right now as he was speaking here in the library of the Institute for Human Sciences. His parents never asked him to stay home, Yuri told me when we met later in Kiev. "You cross a line," he said. "Did you think you could get killed?" I asked. "Yeah, I did." "What can we do?" asked a young Polish woman in the audience. In response, Mykola described a scene from Nikolai Gogol's play, The Inspector General. At the end of the play, a country squire named Piotr Ivanovich Babchinsky approached the Inspector General from the capital of St. Petersburg with a humble request. He begged His Excellency most worshipfully, when he returned to St. Petersburg, to tell the Tsar that there was a man called Piotr Ivanovich Babchinsky who lived in this town, to simply remember that there was a man called Piotr Ivanovich Babchinsky. "Just remember," Mykola answered the young woman, "that there is a country called Ukraine." The grandeur of its intentions. The first represents the exaltation of the executioner by the executioner, wrote the French philosopher Albert Camus, describing the difference between Nazism and Bolshevism. The second, more dramatic in concept, the exaltation of the executioner by the victims. The former never dreamed of liberating all men, but only of liberating a few by subjugating the rest. The latter, in its most profound principle, aims at liberating all men by provisionally enslaving them all. It must be granted the grandeur of its intentions. 21st century Ukraine was heir to the grandeur of these intentions, to daring experiments. "Both Europe and Russia conduct research in our laboratory," wrote the Ukrainian novelist Taras Prohasko. "They experiment, although they have no idea what the result of the synthesis might be." The experiments began long before the Bolshevik Revolution. For centuries, the lands of today's Ukraine were ruled from Vilnius or Warsaw. In the early modern period, these lands were divided between the Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth and the Tsarist Russian Empire. When in the 18th century the Commonwealth was partitioned by its imperial neighbors, Lviv and much of what is now western Ukraine was taken by Habsburg Empress Maria Theresa. Present-day Lviv, previously Polish Lvov, became Austrian Lemberg, the object of the Habsburg Empire's civilizing mission. The First World War brought the old imperial Europe to an end. Early in 1917, bread shortages in frozen Petrograd led to demonstrations, strikes, and mutiny by Tsar Nicholas II's troops. An empire fell. The Tsar abdicated his throne. A precarious dual power took his place. Fragile authority divided between a liberal provisional government and a socialist Petrograd Soviet. As the war against Germany and Austria wore on, disillusioned peasants began to protest. The provisional government convened a militia in the countryside. Peasants seized land and refused to deliver grain. In the cities, there were food shortages. Disenchantment radicalized the peasantry. In April 1917, Lenin arrived in Petrograd, where, in his own words, he found power lying in the streets and simply picked it up. In the midst of anarchy, the Bolsheviks made a radical choice. When in October 1917, Lenin and the Bolsheviks stormed the Winter Palace, they acted on behalf of a metaphysical proletariat, one yet to come into being. Shortly thereafter, Ukrainian leaders in Kiev declared a Ukrainian National Republic. Galician Ukrainian leaders hesitated to join them. Most then still wanted an autonomous Ukrainian crownland within the Habsburg Empire. Soon, though, this became impossible. The Habsburg Empire itself was no more. On 1 November 1918, the Ukrainian National Council declared a West Ukrainian People's Republic, with Lviv as its capital. A week later, Poland declared independence. Through most of November, Polish and Ukrainian forces fought for Lviv in a battle that concluded with a Polish victory and a Polish pogrom against Jews. Habsburg Lemberg, briefly Ukrainian Lviv, was now again Polish Lvov. In March 1918, believing that the worldwide revolution would begin momentarily, Lenin negotiated a separate peace with the Germans. Yet in the lands of what had been the Russian Empire, the war did not end in 1918 at all. It bled into a gruesome civil war between the Bolsheviks and their assorted enemies, as well as between the Bolsheviks and newly independent Poland, created from disparate pieces of the German, Habsburg, and Tsarist empires. Everywhere, people fled violence and pogroms. The lands between Warsaw and Petersburg filled with refugees. Kiev, divided like Paris into a left and right bank, was a large metropolis. Even so, under the pressure of refugees, the city swelled, expanded, overflowed, like leavened dough rising out of its baking tin, as Mikhail Bukokov described in White Guard. By the time it was all over, Kiev had been occupied by five different armies, and four European empires had fallen: German, Ottoman, Habsburg, and Tsarist Russia. Galicia and Western Volhynia, present-day Western Ukraine, belonged to newly independent Poland. Kiev, Kharkiv, Dniepropetrovsk, Odessa, Donetsk, and Luhansk, cities of present-day central and eastern Ukraine, were controlled by the Red Army. In 1922, Lenin declared the formation of the Soviet Union, with the Ukrainian Soviet Socialist Republic as one of its founding constituent republics. 2 years later, Lenin died. When Stalin came into power at the end of that decade, he ordered the collectivization of agriculture. With all means possible and impossible, Ukrainian peasants resisted the confiscation of their property and their land. Collectivization was bloody and savage. Its effect on agricultural productivity was disastrous. After Stalin, in 1932, raised Ukraine's grain procurement quotas by 44%, the peasants could no longer feed themselves. Soviet law required that no grain be distributed to collective farm members until Moscow had received its share. Party officials, aided by regular troops and secret police units, waged a war against peasants who refused to give up their grain. The result of a poor harvest and draconian quotas was mass death. As Stalin forcibly requisitioned their grain, selling it abroad and using the hard currency to fund industrialization, Ukrainian peasants became emaciated, then swollen. Some resorted to cannibalism. In Soviet Ukraine between 1932 and 1934, more than 3.5 million people died of starvation. Then came the Stalinist terror. Stalin declared that just as the socialist victory was assured, the class struggle paradoxically intensified. The enemy, ever more desperate, concealed himself. Now he could be anywhere, including in one's own bed. Constant vigilance was a necessity. No one was to be trusted. Enemies of the people lurked everywhere. They were plotters of counter-revolution. They were wreckers and saboteurs. They were capitalists and imperialists, nationalist conspirators and Trotskyite spies. Stalin had always blamed Ukrainians themselves for the famine. Now this accusation took the fantastical form of an imaginary plot. It was the time of the Great Terror. Mass arrests, confessions extracted by torture, hundreds of thousands of executions. In 1937 and 1938, the NKVD, the Soviet secret police, recorded 123,421 executions in Soviet Ukraine. On 1 September 1939, Nazi Germany attacked Poland. German soldiers appeared briefly in Lvov, yet quickly, as agreed by Hitler and Stalin in the August 1939 Molotov-Ribbentrop Pact, the city was taken by Stalin's Red Army and integrated into Soviet Ukraine. The Red Army, it claimed, had come to liberate Jews and Ukrainians from Polish oppression. Once the Habsburgs had played the Poles against the Ukrainians. Now the Soviets played the Ukrainians against the Poles. Refugees from German-occupied Poland poured into Baroque, once Habsburg Lviv, together with Stalinist terror. "They liberated us, and there's nothing to be done for it," regretted Ukrainian composer Stanislav Ludkovich. This was not the Ukraine the Ukrainians had wanted. When on 22 June 1941 Hitler attacked the Soviet Union, many Ukrainians welcomed the appearance of the Germans as an end to Soviet terror. In eastern Galicia, German soldiers arrived with Ukrainian auxiliaries, many of them members of the Organization of Ukrainian Nationalists faction led by Stepan Bandera. As the Wehrmacht moved eastward in late June and early July 1941, Soviet NKVD officers made mass arrests and in Lviv massacred thousands of their prisoners. German and Ukrainian nationalist propaganda both blamed the massacre on Judeo-Bolsheviks and called for revenge. Jews were forced to collect the corpses of the murdered prisoners. On 30 June 1941, Stepan Bandera's fellow nationalist leader Yaroslav Stetsko proclaimed a Ukrainian state. A day later saw the climax of a Ukrainian pogrom against Jews. Germans filmed the pogrom. Ukrainians carried it out. Ukrainian nationalists had hoped for autonomy under the Germans. They were disappointed. Shortly after the proclamation of Ukrainian statehood, the Germans arrested both Stetsko and Bandera. They also forced Jews into the ghetto. The Ukrainian insurgent army, associated with the Organization of Ukrainian Nationalists, carried out a gruesome ethnic cleansing of Poles in German-occupied former Eastern Poland. By July 1943, Lviv was Yudin Ren. The following summer, on 23 July 1944, the Polish Home Army, anti-German Polish partisans loyal to the Polish government in exile, took partial control of Lviv and fought Ukrainian nationalists. 4 days later, the Red Army occupied the city center. As the war came to an end, both Soviets and Ukrainian locals in eastern Galicia agreed on the desirability of expelling the Poles. Population exchanges were carried out between Soviet Ukraine and Poland. Ethnic unmixing was the spirit of the moment. Moscow sent Russians and Ukrainians from the east to help integrate Galicia and Volhynia. Locals were to be made into Soviets. This social engineering project played out against the backdrop of a partisan war fought by the Ukrainian insurgent army against Soviet forces. The Ukrainian death toll from the Soviet counterinsurgency was approximately 112,000. In the end, the Soviets won. After the war, the Ukrainian Soviet Socialist Republic included the West Ukrainian lands of eastern Galicia and Volhynia, as well as Transcarpathian Ruthenia, taken from Czechoslovakia, and northern Bukovina, taken from Romania. It existed until 1991. That year, the Soviet Union dissolved, and Ukraine, like Russia, Latvia, Lithuania, Estonia, and other former Soviet republics, became its own country. It was a revolutionary moment without a revolution. The Soviet Union was not overthrown, it collapsed. As a result of that collapse, Ukraine received independence. The most breathtaking social engineering experiment the world had known had come to an end. Fantasies of Galicia. Between myself and each new person, the world begins anew, as if nothing up to this time had been established and decided, wrote Bruno Schulz. Schulz, a Polish-Jewish artist and writer, was born in 1892 in an East Galician town named Drohobych. He is famous for his descriptions of the alluring cinnamon shops on the town's market square, blushing salesgirls, men in black bowler hats, bearded Jews in colored gabardines, prostitutes in lacy dresses who might be the wives of barbers, and his family's apartment, full of large closets, deep sofas, pale mirrors, and tacky artificial palms. In his stories, seasons change, temperatures waver, and light trembles. The light is often dim and pale, the imagery often sensuous and tawdry, of crows, butterflies, and cockroaches, of milk cans, lamps, and combs, of thorny acacias and postage stamps of Emperor Franz Joseph. At times, the details approach the repulsive in their lushness. At times, Schulz lingers on the fragile border between the seductive and the grotesque. In the story August, Schulz describes walking with his mother in late summer on the market square until finally, on the corner of Strejka Street, we enter the shadow of the pharmacy. In the pharmacy's wide window, a large bathtub full of raspberry juice symbolized the coolness of the balsams, which could soothe all sufferings. That story is set during Schulz's childhood, when Drohobych was still ruled by the Habsburgs, tucked in a region home to Polish, Ukrainian, Yiddish, and German speakers, to Roman Catholics, Greek Catholics, Armenian Catholics, Orthodox Christians, and Jews. Habsburg Empress Maria Theresa had named Galicia the territory she impolitely took from the Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth in the late 18th century. Galicia, Schulz's homeland, remained in the Empress's family until the Habsburg Empire ceased to exist. For a brief moment in late 1918 and early 1919, Drohobych found itself in the West Ukrainian People's Republic. During the years when Schultz was recalling the pharmacy on Strzeczka Street, Drohobycz belonged to independent Poland. In September 1939, the Red Army invaded eastern Poland and Drohobycz was annexed to Soviet Ukraine. In June 1941, Germany invaded the Soviet Union and the Wehrmacht occupied Drohobycz. Schultz was a Jew. For a time, SS Hauptschaufführer Felix Landau protected Schultz's life in exchange for Schultz painting scenes from fairy tales on the walls of his son's bedroom. Schultz painted until November 1942, when a Gestapo man shot him to death. In February 2001, Yurko Prohasko, a Ukrainian translator and essayist, was among a small team assembled by the German filmmaker Benjamin Geisler that discovered the murals Bruno Schultz had painted for Landau. By then, Drohobycz belonged to independent Ukraine. Yurko had been skeptical when Geisler had called and asked for his help. "I'll find them," the filmmaker insisted. At the villa, from whose balcony Landau once shot at passers-by, there lived an elderly woman, dressed in black, in mourning for her son. It was 2 days before what would have been his 50th birthday. The old woman did not know who Bruno Schultz was. Even so, she allowed the visitors to come inside. The room Yurko entered was small. In the first moments, the images on the wall were hazy. Then, with some labor, they revealed themselves. A dancer and a gnome. A princess and a king. A coach and a rider. The head of a horse, a monster. Bruno Schultz mattered to Yurko Prohasko. Schultz and his work belonged to a lost paradise named Galicia. It was the world Yurko had longed for as a child growing up in Ivano-Frankivsk, some 80 miles from Drohobycz. By the time Yurko was born in 1970, Ivano-Frankivsk had been part of the Soviet Union for a quarter century. Yet in his parents' apartment there remained objects, everything that composed the texture of daily life. These were remnants of a lost paradise, which I summarized for myself with the mythical word Galicia. Although family history was important to his mother, and she told her sons about their grandparents and great-grandparents, Yurko's mother never suggested that this older world had been an idyllic one. Yurko conjured up that vision by himself. It seemed obvious to him that all things from that older world, buildings, objects, art, language, were superior to what had replaced them. At school, he was taught that the Soviet Union had brought progress in every realm of life, yet even as a child, Yurko could see that this was not progress but deterioration. Above all, an aesthetic and moral deterioration. It was not only objects that summoned Yurko to this mythical Galicia. There were people, too. Certain elderly people who spoke an archaic Ukrainian, whose eyes held a different expression, whose gesticulations and mannerisms all suggested that they were remnants of this lost world. The novelist Yuri Andrukhovich, older than Yurko by 10 years, also grew up in Ivano-Frankivsk. He, too, noticed in his youth those elderly people who spoke a Galician dialect, remembered Latin proverbs from their school days, and dressed as if they were on their way to greet Habsburg Archduke Franz Ferdinand. Perhaps, Andrukhovich wrote, they constituted some kind of secret association, an esoteric imperial royal club named after Bruno Schultz. To him, they appeared to be creatures from another planet. He was attentive to their existence, but he was not seduced by them. Yurko was. It was a libidinal attraction that was the counterpart of his visceral aversion to the Sovietness that surrounded and washed away our archaic, museum-like Galicianness. He described his feelings toward the world these elderly people evoked. idealization would be too weak. I would rather say mystification or some kind of aspiration to transcendence. I would describe it in German as Verlustlust. That is, there's lust, there's Eros, which cannot be gotten rid of because it's everywhere, but that Eros is directed towards things that have already been lost. Yurko himself did not imitate that pre-war aesthetic. When we met in Lviv in April 2014, he was clean-shaven and wearing jeans. Light brown hair fell into very bright blue eyes. His own work encompassed literature from the whole of the 20th century. He translated Robert Musil, Joseph Roth, and Franz Kafka from German, Yusef Vitlin, Jaroslav Iwaszkiewicz, and Leszek Kolwakowski from Polish, Deborah Vogel from Yiddish. The Polish-Jewish poet Deborah Vogel had been a close friend of Bruno Schulz, and like Schulz, Vogel was killed in 1942 by the Germans. Yurko's own essays were inflected with the timbres of all these voices. There was a kind of impassioned softness in his writing. The historical milieu of which Yurko felt himself a part was embedded in that world of Bruno Schulz. It was a milieu whose existence was suspected by few. He was descended from the uniate clerico nobility, Greek, Catholic, Galician Ukrainians who had neither Polonized nor Russified, Ukrainophiles who embraced the liberal nationalism of the 1848 European revolutions. This tiny milieu, among the last handful of liberals in interwar Europe, never accepted the radical nationalism of Stepan Bandera and the Ukrainian insurgent army, never accepted their hostility towards Poles, Jews, and others, never accepted their use of terrorism and ethnic cleansing. That legacy was never their own. This all led to my growing up in a world of fantasized exclusivity, Yurko described. He felt that all that was best had been lost. He spent his youth persuaded that most people who belonged to the unaesthetic Soviet world could not understand him. Later, as an adult, Yurko went to Austria, where he was trained in psychoanalysis. He came to understand his feelings about belonging to a lost paradise as a narcissistic fantasy, requiring reflection. Yurko grew up speaking Ukrainian and Russian. He learned Polish and German because these were the Galician languages of his grandparents' time. His maternal grandparents had studied in Vienna. His grandmother had once practiced medicine in Vienna's 19th district. It was the money they earned there that allowed them to return to eastern Galicia and build the home where Yurko grew up. At the time, in the 1930s, everything about that building was modern. The Bauhaus architecture, the furniture, the central heating, the electricity, the lamps. His grandparents, descended from the Ukrainian clerico nobility, were bearers of European modernity. In 1939 came the catastrophe. Together, Nazism and Stalinism destroyed an entire world, and of that very small milieu, of that ethos of aristocratic, Greek, Catholic, liberal Ukrainian patriotism, very little survived. His grandparents were the last generation with a taste for modernity, in contrast to Yurko himself. Because as a result of that loss, of that Verlustlust, I like only antiques. Yurko's mother, born in 1940 during the Red Army's occupation of eastern Galicia, had always been a Ukrainian patriot. As a girl growing up during late Stalinism, she saw the disaster that Soviet rule was for her family. Their property was expropriated. Some relatives were shot. Others lost their minds in prison. Even so, she wanted very much to sing the beautiful songs and believe that the Soviet Union wished for peace throughout the world. To Yurko, she was deeply good and deeply naive. He described her as an orchid of catastrophe. Yurko's father was different. He came not from the Greek Catholic nobility, but from an upwardly mobile Ukrainophile family whose property was confiscated by the Bolsheviks. Yurko's great-grandfather was an engineer who, together with his daughter and grandson, Yurko's father, was sent to the Gulag in 1948. Yurko's father was then 8 years old. He grew up in Stalin's camps, where adolescents were already criminals. In the Gulag, teenage boys would play cards and the winners would select a stranger whom the loser would have to kill. The one who lost would have to enter a room where a film was being shown and stab to death, for instance, the person who was sitting in the first seat in the fourth row. And so, in contrast to Yurko's mother, Yurko's father never had any illusions about the Soviet world. Yet he was the one who joined the Communist Party. It was a gesture of pragmatic conformity. He and Yurko's mother lived in an apartment in the Bauhaus-style stone building her parents had built in the 1930s. He provided for them. He had grown up in the Gulag. He understood well what happened to people who opposed the Soviet regime, and he did not want that, not for himself and not for his family. And Yurko loved his father, although in his eyes his father was a traitor. It was his mother's world, the world that had brought fin de siècle Viennese modernism to eastern Galicia, he idealized. I didn't understand then that in my father there was much vitality, and on the other side there was much morbidity. But I preferred the noble morbidity to the opportunistic vitality. Yurko himself never believed in the Soviet promise. The libidinal identification with the bygone Galician world was too absorbing, the Soviet world too repelling. When at 17 Yurko left home, it was to study German philosophy in Lviv. At that time, 1987, the possibility of meeting an actual German was remote. German literature was a purely idealistic undertaking, an attempt to connect with that no longer existing world in which German had been the language of high culture. Once, Lviv had been the capital of Austrian Galicia. To Yurko, it was the epicenter of the cosmos. To reach Lviv was like reaching Jerusalem. By then, the reformer Mikhail Gorbachev had come to power in the Soviet Union. It was the time of glasnost and perestroika. And it was all at the right moment, he described, because just at this time comes sexuality, the desire for emancipation from the father, first love, dreams about the future, Gorbachev. It meant the possibility of change and of liberation. There were thousands of demonstrations, protests against atomic energy in the wake of the 1986 nuclear disaster at Chernobyl, marches and rallies in support of the Ukrainian language, the Greek Catholic Church, Ukrainian independence. Yurko took part in all of it. Those demonstrations were his civic education. At the time, at the end of the 1980s, Yurko had believed that what was happening in Ukraine was just like what was happening in Poland, Czechoslovakia, Hungary, and elsewhere in Eastern Europe. He did not foresee the persistence of Sovietness. He did not see that Ukraine was different.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.